first three lectures, we've essentially talked about the definition and the structure of tropical varieties. So the idea is now, over the last two lectures, I would start to talk about some applications. This is only going to be, this is not going to be all applications. This is going to be a very small subset of the applications. Like there's many directions you could go for this. There's symmetry, real algebraic geometry, and we're not going to go anywhere near any of these. So I just want to talk about some very small sort of subsets of ways you might want to use tropical geometry. So today we're connected with the theme of torrid connections. So we're going to start by discussing connections with torrid varieties. So I don't want to, well maybe I should ask a question. Actually maybe I should find out who knows what a torrid variety is in this audience. So I don't want to assume that, so I'm going to start by reviewing. I'm going to ask you though, I will ask your forbearance, that you're going to have to take some things on faith. Mostly you're going to have to believe that there are nice generalizations. Toric varieties are nice generalizations of projective space. So I'm going to spend some time telling you how projective space is a toric variety and ask you to believe that this does generalize for me. Well, let's start with just a definition. So A to be normal toric variety. It'll be a normal variety X with it containing a dense copy of C star to the X. So technically, you can work over, so maybe we'll just say today K is going to be the complex numbers. Okay, you could work over other fields when we're talking about toric variety, because I haven't actually finished this definition yet either, I should say. You could work over other fields, but the content is, for K being C star, the content I want to make is that my tropical varieties are going to be fans. Okay, we're not going to get, so trop y is a fan. So you remember that means it's a union of cones. So we're just getting pictures like this. There's not going to be any finite regions. So back to the definition, it's a normal variety containing a dense copy of C star in the N with an action call this T for torus of T on X extending the action of C star to the M. The action of T on its. Okay, so T is a group by coordinate wise multiplication. Okay? We call it the algebraic torus because if you think C star, let's see, take away the origin, deformation retracts to a circle. So C star to the N is topologically an A torus. And we've got an act, so this is a group though by coordinate wise multiplication, it acts on itself, and we want it to also act on X. Okay, so you know many examples, we might take X to be C star to the N. Okay, that definitely contains C star to the N as a dense copy, and it acts on itself. You might take X to be A to the N, okay, which contains the set of X such that XI is not 0 for 1 less than or equal to I less than or equal to N. So my affine space is a perfectly good toric variety. C star to the N still acts coordinate-wise on AN. I might take X to be projective space. Okay, this now has the projective points X such that XI is non-zero for 0 less than or equal to I less than or equal to N. Okay, so these are all, and again, so this is the tor. If I take the set of non-zero coordinates, that's going to be isomorphic to C star to the N. Okay, I've got vectors of like N plus 1 modulo my coordinates. Okay. So these are all examples of toric varieties. We can have many more. We might take X to be P P1 cross P1. And then there's many more. Okay. What we want to take use of here, though, is a toric variety is a union of T orbits. Okay, this is obvious. Whenever we have a group acting on a set, you can decompose it as a union of orbits. Let's remind ourselves, though, for P2. How do I write P2? I can write it as C star squared. Okay, that's my points with every coordinate non-zero. Union, I could take the set of points on the star star zero. So these are non-zero. Union star zero star. Union zero star star. Union, then we have the three fixed points, 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, and 0, 0. Okay, so P2 is a union of 7 torus orbits. Okay, remember, torus is acting by coordinate-wise multiplication, so this just means I can take any element of this form to any other element of this form. Okay. I'm going to record this in a polyhedral fan. So we'll record this. So the picture I draw is going to be this, but I'll record maybe for around 2. This cone, so the dimension of sigma, the dimension of the orbit is going to be n, the ambient dimension, minus the dimension of sigma. So I'm going to put my fixed points here on the top dimensional cones, and then here I will put the orbit star star 0, here I will put the orbit star 0 star, and here the vertex I'm going to put C star here. So you can think about this as just, if you've never seen a toric variety, think about this picture as just recording the intersection, you know, the relationships between the orbits. If orbits are adjacent, that means that one lives in the closure of the other one. Okay. So normally, when we introduce toric varieties, we go the other way. We start with a fan. So more traditionally, in sigma, we construct a toric variety x sigma, and it's going to be the disjoint union u, so it's the disjoint union of o sigma, the sigma in the sigma with the closure relations or maybe let's say the topology given by sigma. Those of you who actually know toric varieties know that this is not a definition. What do I mean by this? This is meant to be enough of the hope is that this is enough of a definition for those of you who haven't seen it to take it to account. Every time I draw a fan, I've really told you a variety. The vertex will be a copy of C star, or to the dimension, in this case C star squared. Each line will be a codimension 1 copy of C star to the n minus 1. Each, all the way down to each maximal cone will be a point. Okay? If I want to know which orbits live in the closure of a particular orbit, I look at which cones contain that. So everything lives in the closure of C star squared. These two fixed points live in the closure of this orbit here. So you look at the cones that contain it. So the fan tells you the topology. It tells you how we glue these orbits together. And technically, I mean, what I'm saying is only really defining for you. I mean, toric varieties are more general than smooth toric varieties, and this is sort of, so I'm cheating quite a lot to say this, but the idea is if you've never seen a toric variety before, you should think for the rest of this lecture, projective space is your favourite toric variety, and whenever I write down a fan, I can define a toric variety. And that toric variety will be a union of orbits, and the fan tells me how the orbits intersect. Okay. Okay. So maybe we should say one or two more sentences. There's actually a complete dictionary between properties of the fan and properties of the variety. So in particular, maybe. Dictionary. Between properties of the fan sigma and properties of X. Okay, so the dimension of the ambient space is going to be the dimension of sigma, the number of torus orbits is going to be the number of cones, and then a lot more. So in particular, maybe one example, there is a combinatorial, so description of the Chow ring H star of X. Okay, so this is one of those few cases that Joe talked about that we can actually describe Chow rings of varieties, is if we have a toric variety. Again, experts know that I'm cheating, but let's pretend we're talking about some toric varieties from this perspective. And maybe projective. But okay, so we have a combinatorial rule. This is one of the ways where we have a dictionary. Okay. And maybe this is a good, I want to mention two references, but if you want to. One is a book by, Fulton has a nice book on toric varieties, but then and there's another book that's just come out, and I think this book is available for pre-order, but it might still be on David Cox's webpage. A few weeks ago, it was still on David.
Last week,
this was still on David Cox's webpage, and so strongly recommended that you download it while you still can.
800 pages.
Exactly. The webpage claims that it's going to disappear once the book is made available, and Springer will now take your money to buy the book, so we don't have much time.
That's always a book, Gashin.
Okay. So that's the lightning introduction to toric varieties. If you're not a toric variety person, for everything I say from now on, essentially, you can think about projective space as a toric variety. Okay? It may or may not give you an interesting example, but it will always make sense. Okay? Here's the question. So given a variety Y in X sigma, Y bar, or which torus orbits does Y bar intersect? Okay. So equivalently, so e.g., if Y bar is in projective space with a choice of coordinates here, which coordinate hyperplanes Y bar intersect? Or which collection of coordinate hyperplanes? Okay. You'll notice that this question does not contain the word tropical anywhere. Okay. If it was at a principle, if, depending on how you've described for me this variety, this is a question you can answer, right? You give me the variety, maybe you give me the variety by equations in projective space. I could go to all to the 2 to the n plus 1 different possible intersections of coordinate hyperplanes, add those variables, decide if that variety was non-empty. Okay, so that would be one way to answer this question. Surprising answer is the surprising fact is that tropical geometry gives you a way to answer this question. So the answer is, this is due to Tevayev, is that Y bar intersects the torus orbit indexed by sigma if and only if the tropicalization of Y bar intersect T intersects the relative interior of sigma. Okay, so the idea is here you have some toric surface, say, so maybe your toric sigma. Say again? Sorry, I'll double sigma. Was that another correction or that one?
Yeah.
Okay. So you've got your fan, here's your fan of your toric variety, and now you have your suppose, so this would be a picture of a the fan describing a toric surface. I now take my tropical variety, remember I'm in the complex numbers, so this is just going to be a fan, and I look here, and what is this telling me? This is telling me that this toric surface intersects the torus, and also intersects this torus fixed point, this torus fixed point, this torus fixed point, and this torus fixed point. So it doesn't intersect any of the codimension 1 torus orbits, but it intersects these 4 torus fixed points. So this is somehow the surprising way that it's not clear what, from the question that tropical geometry will have anything to do, but somehow tropical geometry tells us the answer to this question. So let's see an example of this in the case of projective space. Okay, so let's come back to our tropical line. If I have just a line in P2, for example, the variety of x plus y plus z, and then I look at which torus orbits it intersects. Okay, so for example, let's take y bar to be the variety of x plus y plus z in P2. Okay, so now this is a line. We can tell that this intersects, you could say, y bar does not contain any of the fixed points. Okay, you just take these points, you substitute them into this equation, and you check that you don't get zero. But it does intersect every other torus orbit. Okay, we can get the points sort of a minus a zero for a non-zero will give me a point in. Let's see, if I lost my, I guess we've lost. I've just erased the other my torus orbits for P2. Okay, so okay, but y bar intersects every other torus orbit. Okay, so what is y bar intersect T? So y bar intersect T, that's the variety of just, let's say, x plus y plus 1 contained in C star squared. Okay, what's the tropical variety? Tropical y bar is just my tropical line. Okay, this is the picture we've drawn multiple times. Why is this? Remember, I just turned this into the minimum of x, y, and 0. This is 0, y, and x. That's my piecewise linear function. I take the non-linear locus, and I get this as my tropical variety. What does this have to do with the fan? Remember, my fan for P2 was precisely this. Okay, with these cones, and these cones. So what it's saying is the tropical variety intersects the relative interior of every cone except for the relative interior of the maximal ones. That's the same as saying y by theorem, y bar intersects every torus orbit except for my three torus fixed points. Okay, so this is an example of this. And if you do, maybe the an exercise would be to check if I take something like if I take f to be xy plus xz plus yz plus z squared, and if I look at the variety of f, so maybe I won't do this, but if you get bored later, check, I mean, your tropical variety in this case should look like this. Once I, if I dehomogenize, so that means set z to be 1, I'll get a tropical variety like this, and then you can check that that does, you know, if I compare it to my to my EFAD for P2, that it does intersect the orbits the way you think it does. Okay. So that's the exercise. Okay, so that's the first part. This is the how tropical geometry tells us how we intersect. Is there a question? Yeah.
So every curve P2 will essentially have a general curve, will not intersect those points. So
that's right. Yeah, okay, that's a great question. So a general curve, the observation is a general curve in P2 won't intersect those points. So that's saying, what I'm saying, so as you're pointing out, that means that a general curve in P2 over C, if we're working in the complex numbers, will have a tropical variety that looks like this. Okay? So what about the weights? The only information we've got left is the weights. If I tell you that this one has weight D, if it's going to be balanced, well, I'm going to write, this means I'm writing down an equation that goes d times 1, 0 plus something times 0, 1 plus something times negative 1, negative 1. Well, that, my something here must be a d, but then this has to be a d as well. So my tropical variety must be multiplicities d, d, and d, and this will be the degree of the curve. So in generic, so a general curve, another way of saying that is if I make a general change of coordinates on my curve, I will end up with this as my tropical variety. So somehow this told you that, you know, tropical, if we work over the complex numbers, we don't want to take general curves, because then all we remember is dimension and degree. We care about special choices of coordinates. And then this is going to be true even more so when we, so maybe with that an answer. Yeah, so more questions? Yeah. So this actually, maybe the other observation was that this helps you work out what the tropical variety is, right? Why did we know this was the tropical variety? Well, we knew it had to not intersect any of these three cones, but it had to be one-dimensional and it had to be balanced. Okay, so that told you it had to be this. Okay, so this already gives you a kind of information. Okay. So more questions, comments? So let me ask a different question. So this is, instead of talking about how things intersect, let's talk about compactifications. So the next question is given a subvariety y in t, how can we find a good compactification? How can... So we heard this morning why this is an important question, right? We heard, you know, this morning we were talking about taking smooth conics and finding a good compactification for the space of smooth conics so that we could do intersection theory in the way we wanted to. Okay, so that's one example of why you might care. The other thing is we might just start, but maybe I want to take a bit of time though first convincing you that you should care about compactifying subvarieties of a torus. Okay. On the first lecture I said, well, you all care about subvarieties of tori because you care about projective varieties. Okay, so you start with a projective variety. You choose a projective embedding, intersect with the torus. You have a subvariety of a torus. Your variety that you started with is a compactification of that subvariety of a torus. It might or might not be a compactification you're happy with. Okay, one way to think about, for example, things like resolution of singularities would be to say maybe you arrange things so that none of your singularities lie in the torus. And then a resolution of singularities might be a different choice of a compactification of your subvariety intersecting the torus. Okay? So there's many questions you could phrase this way. Let me give you one concrete question that we'll come back, we're going to specialize in a moment into, of an example of a subvariety of the torus that you might want to compactify, or that other people have wanted to compactify in the past. So I want to start with an arrangement of hyperplanes. So HS, a hyperplane arrangement. In projective space. I mean a hyperplane, yes. I've encoded it to one. Yeah. Okay, I'm going to say even more explicitly in 30 seconds. And so yeah, what do I mean by this? I mean HI is the set of X in PN such that I've even chosen coordinates on PN here. Okay, so such that AI dot X equals zero, where AI here, I'm thinking of it as living in C to the N. Okay, so I've chosen coordinates, I've really been an almost a hyperplane in projective space. Okay, so the hyperplane arrangement is just a collection of the hyperplanes, but what we're really interested in, so this has been a question, this is one of the, I guess, the basic equations, particularly, I guess, started maybe from the topological side, is to consider the complement of the hyperplane arrangement. So, I'm going to let my variety y be, let y E be the complement of my hyperplane arrangement. So just take Pn, remove your hyperplanes. Okay, so this is a space that you might want to understand. If you were a topologist, you might want to understand the topology of the space. Sometimes, in particular, depending on your choice of hyperplanes, you might be able to get interesting groups as fundamental groups, and so on. So this is a subject for which there's a lot of rich combinatorics in topology. We want to talk a little bit about turbines in algebraic geometry. So first I should convince you that this is actually a subvariety of the torus. Okay, in a closed subvariety of the torus. Okay, why is that? Well, I would say y embeds into C star to the s minus 1. So I guess, did I say this at the start? I want to assume here, let's assume that s is bigger than n plus 1. So I'll take y, look at y, e to the vector a1 dot y colon up to as dot y. Okay, so this will be, I've chosen something as a complement of the hyperplane arrangement. So I don't live on any of these hyperplanes, so none of these points is zero. None of these numbers here is zero. Okay, so I'm taking each point and I'm measuring its distance from every hyperplane. And so I'll take projective coordinates, which is why this is a minus 1. Okay? This is a variety. Okay? Why is it a variety? So y is now the variety of, cut up by linear equations, let me get my coordinates correct, j equals 1 to s, bij xj, where 1 is less than or equal to I, is less than or equal to s minus n minus 1, where here if I write the matrix B, so I've got my equations. Each equation here, I've got linear equations cut out by the rows of this matrix B. B here is an S minus N minus 1 times N plus 1 matrix, and it has the property that A times B transpose is 0. Okay. You can see that if I have anything in the kernel of A, it will vanish. That polynomial will vanish on y. You just have to check that that's everything. Okay, that everything here, that y is precisely this. So this is an easy exercise. If I shut up for 5 minutes, you could all actually we check that this was the case. Okay? So why is it we take a hyperplane arrangement, we embed it into some big torus, and we see it as a closed subvariety. Okay. So we now have a subvariety of a torus. We might want to compactify it. Now you might think that this is an incredibly stupid thing to say, because I started with projective space. I removed my hyperplanes. Projective space is a compactification of Y. Okay, so Pn is one compactification, but if you want to think about my hyperplanes as particular divisors here, it's not a good choice of compactification in the sense of the boundary. My divisors don't have normal crossings, they don't tell a lot of the geometry. Okay, so we can say Pn then is one compactification. Of Y. So can we find a better one? So a better one. And better here means that the boundary, the things we add to Y, should, for example, have simple normal crossings. Should behave better. This is a problem that was for which one answer was given by Di Cicchini and Bruchesi. They described what's called the wonderful model of a hyperplane arrangement. And I'll say a few words about that later if we come back to that. Okay, but this is an example of the sort of thing that you might, of the sort of subvariety of tori that you might want to compactify. Okay. So how are we going to do this? So it works like this. We're going to start with Y. So the definition is, so given a subvariety, Y contained in T, E, we want to choose a fan. This will be a rational fan, I guess I should say a rational polyhedral fan, sigma with support. The other day that there might be multiple choices of this sigma, and there might not, a priori at least, be a coarsest possible choice. But so choose one. Okay? So now what do we have? We have a toric variety. So then we have Y is contained in T by definition, and that torus is contained in X sigma. Okay? So T is going to, I would regard T as the torus of my toric variety. Okay, and the Y bar, this is a definition, being the closure of Y in X sigma, is a tropical compactification. Inside this toric variety is again due to Tavalev. I'm not quite following his notation here. I'll just because I think this is the more fundamental operation. Okay. So for example, why would we want to do this? So this has some nice properties. So the first thing I want you to notice, what do they do with the eraser? So the first thing I should warn you about is that this toric variety we're taking the closure in is not compact. Okay, you might take so maybe before I say why it has nice properties, so warning, we should say X sigma is not compact, it's not a complete, let's say it's not complete, so it's not a compact variety. Okay, you might have taken, if we took the line X plus Y plus 1, the tropical line is this. This is a fan with three one-dimensional cones. Okay, so X sigma is P2, take away 3 points. Okay, so this is a non-compact toric variety. Okay. However, if you take your favorite curve that doesn't pass through those 3 points, intersect it with the torus, and compactify, you're going to get the curve back again, right? You won't care about the fact that you were taking the closure in something non-compact, you'll still get something that's non-compact. Okay? That's what happens here. So the nice properties is that we do have Y bar is complete or compact. Okay, so it's going to be right. Okay, and the second nice property is that Y bar intersects a codimension K torus orbit of the toric variety in codimension K. Okay, so that says the code. So I said the orbits are dimension reversing, so the rays correspond to codimension 1 things, or torus invariant divisors. The intersection, that says you take Y bar, you intersect with Y bar, with a torus invariant divisor, you're getting a divisor of Y bar. More interestingly, you intersect with something that's codimension 2, you get something that's codimension 2. You intersect something with codimension 3, you get something that's codimension 3. Okay, so in particular, your divisors that you got in this fashion, they intersect well. The intersection of any, you know, 5 of your divisors are going to intersect in codimension 5. So this is what you might call combinatorial normal crossings. Okay, so somehow it's sort of like being, my divisors at least behave, intersect as if they are complete intersections. Okay, we can get better though if we choose. So this is if we choose our fan to be even finer, and sometimes in the pictures I've drawn so far, any fan worked. But so if the fan is chosen. If the fan sigma is chosen sufficiently fine. Okay, so you'll remember that I said two properties of a fan, of the, why did we know that the tropical variety was a fan in, or was a polyhedral complex in general? We knew this because we knew, because of this Grosvenor connection I talked about yesterday. Because we knew there was a polyhedral complex called the Grosvenor complex, which said where the initial ideal was constant on fans. So if the fan is chosen sufficiently fine, so e.g. if we take nw of I of y constant on cones, okay, and also x sigma is smooth. So these are two niceness conditions that you can guarantee by just refining your fan if necessary. If we do this, then we get two more conditions. We're going to get the multiplicity uw sigma on a top dimensional cone. Class of Y bar or intersect with V sigma, where this is the torus orbit closure. Okay, so I said every cone corresponded to a torus orbit. Remember P2, each cone, I have 7 cones in this picture, they all correspond to a torus orbit. For example, remember we had things like this was the orbit star 0. The closure of this adds the two torus fixed points. In that case, this is going to be a line in P2. In general, it will be some torus invariant subvariety, these torus invariant subdivisors, but I said we know the Chow ring. In fact, it's so nice that we know these are, well, they don't have a basis, but these torus invariant subvarieties span the Chow groups in each dimension. So what this is saying is we know how the class of Y, this is inside Chow. So this is in A star of X sigma. Have to be a little careful because, you know, X, as I said, X sigma is not going to be complete. But, you know, making sense of this in an appropriate sense. So what are we saying? We're saying we know how Y bar intersects a basis of complementary cycles. Okay, so what that really says is that we know the class of Y bar in this toric variety. Okay, so the multiplicities give me the class of intactification in the toric, in this toric variety.
So multiplicity is the weight in the tropical.
That's the weight of the tropical variety. Which you remember, so this is why you have to remember, where did those multiplicities come from? They just depended on Y. They didn't depend on Y bar. So somehow Y knew about this compactification. Okay, so we say this is it. So Y bar, so we can say maybe trop Y. Ooh, the weights. Determines the class of Y in the toric variety. So this is a little surprising, right? I mean, we're saying I took something that depended only on my subvariety of the torus, and it somehow knew about the class in the Chandra given associated toric variety of a compactification.
Just curious, as the fan gets finer and finer, doesn't the
toric variety changes.
Get larger and larger.
Yeah.
So how can the, I mean, there's a finite number of weights.
Ah.
How can they determine the
class? No, there's not a finite. So, okay, as the fan gets finer, so I started with this.
Yeah.
Okay. Now I'm going to subdivide it. And now, what have I told you? I've now told you, here's a cone and here's a cone. Okay. So, yeah, so Joe's point is actually, it's not just one compactification, it's a priori an infinite number of different compactifications. Okay. The good thing about toric varieties is that most of these compactifications are related by blow-ups. Okay, because as I subdivide the fan, I'm just blowing up the toric variety, so I'm just blowing up the compactification. So yeah, if you get from one fan to another by just doing this, I'm going to get from one compactification to another one by blowing up. Okay. But yeah, so this is really saying this is telling me this class of these infinitely many compactifications in the Chow ring of infinitely many toric varieties. Okay, so it remembers a lot of information about the compactification. Okay, so more questions? Okay, do I want to... Okay, that's... Oh, I have one more niceness property before I spend the rest of the time on examples. Okay. And now the other one is for any sigma... In sigma, Y bar intersect O sigma. This will be, if it's done carefully, will be the variety of NY of I bar. We have to be a little careful up to subdivision here, but we take the variety mod K star to the dimension of Y sigma. Okay, so this is assumed if I take, so if this is taken to be the Grover fan. Okay, so with appropriate requirements, remember, you know, this, I take the initial ideal, this is by a union of torus orbits, or a union, it's in this case, in the top dimensional, it was a union of torus orbits, so I mod out by it and I get those are my points I add. In the so maximal cones will be points. That's the statement about intersecting codimension K in codimension K. And other things, it'll be some funny variety cross some torus orbits, I mod out by the torus orbits, and that's precisely what I'm adding when I take the compactification. Let me do some. I'm sort of realizing as I write this, I'm slipping a. There's a niceness condition that I'm going to avoid that, be precise. But okay, let me spend the rest of the time perhaps doing some examples of this. So the first is to come back to the subvariety of the torus. To come back to the hyperfederation. Okay, so. If I take Y to be En, take away my hyperplane arrangement, and then we'll say plus some very mild assumptions on A. These are sort of combinatorial things about, you know, you want it, there's a particular configuration you want to not show up here. Then there is a coarsest possible
possible fan structure. On X sigma, sorry, on top Y. Okay, and Y bar, so this is the closure of Y E in X sigma, is the De Concini Patrese wonderful compactification.
The assumption is on the intersection process of A, or?
Yeah, more or less. Yeah, we want something like, for example, for, if it's line arrangements, if it was a line arrangement in P2, the only thing you want to rule out is a bunch of curves that lines that look like this. Okay, so anything else other than that for line arrangements is fine. Okay. So that's one example. So this is a just that one. This is not balanced. Yeah, exactly. It's a tropical Asian blackboards.
But the wonderful compactification works in all borough arrangements. What do you get when it isn't? I mean, they constructed this compactification for all arrangements.
Mm-hmm.
What do you get when
So. You mean, so with the, without having removed the mild assumptions, the problem that this will be, the tropical compactification, let's see, I don't, for line arrangements at least this is true, I haven't actually thought this through in general, I think the claim is it's a blowdown. So the wonderful compactification might be a blow up of the tropical compactification. So it might be somehow more than you need. Okay. So that was one example. So maybe the take-home point, if you've never seen these words before, you should think that quite some time ago now, people already thought about trying to compactify these. This gives a sort of conceptual way to say, let's do it, let's describe the compactification in a couple of lines. Okay, I'm describing my two examples are out of historical order, however, because in some sense this was motivated by the next example. That's going to be the example of M0N bar, so this is the moduli space, which we've already seen, of stable G to 0 curves with N marked points. 0 curves. Okay, so this is, let me start, we've seen this in passing sort of in a few talks, but let me sort of back up and remind you what this is. So if I start with M0N with no bar, is the moduli space is of smooth genus zero curves with N marked points, so smooth genus zero curves. With N marked points. So this means it's just ways to arrange N points on P1. So it's N points on P1 up to the automorphism group of P1, which is just PGL2. Okay. So this is a nice, we'll take N to be at least 3. This is a fine moduli space in the sense that Rob talked about. We don't have to worry about any of what, in this case for G to 0 with N at least 3, we don't have to worry about any of the complications Robin discussed this morning. We can just, I didn't want to do that. I want to go to this board. Okay, so let's do some examples. The first example of M0N would be if N is 3. The one fact you should remember about projective geometry is that there's an automorphism, a unique automorphism of P1 that takes any 3 distinct points to any other 3 distinct points. So this says M0N3 is a point. The good thing about this is I've taken care of all my automorphisms now. So if I have 4 distinct points, then I can take, and these points are labeled, I should say, so I can take point 1 to 0, point 2 to 1, point 3 to infinity, and now point 4, well, it's going somewhere else, but wherever else it goes, whose different choices are different. I've used up all my homomorphisms, so this is going to be P1, take away 0, 1, or infinity. And in general, M0n is P1 take away 0, 1 to infinity to the n minus 3 take away the diagonals. Okay, so that means I'm saying take point 1 to 0, point 2 to 1, point 3 to infinity, and now take keep track of where the points 4, 5, 6, 7 up to n go. But they can't be 0, 1, or infinity, because my points should be different. I guess I didn't actually say that somewhere, so n distinct points. And they should be different from each other. Okay. Let's say this a bit more slowly, though. So m0, n still, this is going to be, well, if I'm taking away 0 and infinity, this looks like I'm taking away c star, or take away 1. The n minus 3, take away the diagonal. But another way of writing this would be to write it as p to the n minus 3, take away x naught equals, so I want to say xi equals 0 for 0 less than or equal to I less than or equal to 1. I might have to take away xi equals x naught for 0 less than for 1 less than or equal to I less than or equal to n. And I want to take away xi equals xj. So really, I guess, for 1 less than or equal to I less than j less than or equal to n. Okay? This is the projectivizing. So that's adding the hyperplane at infinity. Well, I mean, I added the hyperplane at infinity and I took it back out again. That's taking away the 1. And this is taking away what I said is the diagonal, saying that the points are distinct. Okay, so you can see that this is really, so it's p to the n minus 3, take away, well, what have I got? These are really the same condition, right? So it's n plus 1, choose 2, plus n plus 1. This is n minus 3. So this is n minus 3, choose, so n minus 2, choose 2, plus n minus 2, which is n minus 1, choose 2. So what's the content of this? This is saying M0N is a hyperplane arrangement. We're saying M0N is a hyperplane arrangement complement. Okay, so we already know from the previous example that it embeds into it's a subvariety of a torus. So again, I'll just work over the complex numbers for simplicity. So thus, we can say, thus M0N is a subvariety of C star to the N in minus 1 choose 2 minus 1, which is also, I prefer to write this as C star to the N choose 2 minus N. Okay, so that's just an exercise if I don't get questions. Okay, so we have M0N is now a subvariety of a torus. Okay? If you've learned nothing else this week, you should have learned that if you see a subvariety of a torus, you should tropicalize it. Okay, so what happens? So trop M0N. So, well, first of all, what is it? Well, we know it's going to be the dimension of M0n, which was n minus 3, so it is a n minus 3 dimensional fan in r to the n choose 2 minus n, because that's the dimension of my torus. Okay, what is that fan? Somehow the miracle is that this is a fan that existed before algebraic geometry started being interested in it. Okay, this is called the space of phylogenetic trees. So phylogenetics is a part of mathematical biology.
So a phylogenetic tree is some sort of thing from evolution, sort of saying that maybe, I don't know, cows over here, and then we have chimps here, and we have humans here. So this is saying that maybe we're more closely related to chimps than we are to cows. And so in general, if we want to look at all possible evolutionary relationships, we're going to get, we get a fan in this way. So let me draw some pictures to illustrate this. So this was the same way. So this is the same way as we did it with the hyperplane arrangement. Whenever I have this, any hyperplane ribbon, any hyperplane arrangement complement embeds into C star to the number of hyperplanes minus one. And it's just I take my point to the distance from the hyperplane. Yeah. So phylogenetic trees. If I take here as the space of phylogenetic trees, so I guess I should say a phylogenetic tree. E is a tree with n labeled leaves. And this is tree in the sense of graph theory, so a graph with no cycles. Okay, leaf is a vertex of degree one. This will be clearer from as I draw the picture. So here is one example. Here is another example. Okay. Now the idea is, how do I turn this into a fan? I draw a combinatorial type. Each cone corresponds to a combinatorial type of tree. And then the distance keeps track of the length of the internal edge. Okay, so you can see, if I have four leaves, there's only three different types of combinatorial or tree with three labeled leaves. And then I guess the vertex here corresponds to just the one where they're all zero. Okay. Let me draw maybe one more example with...
Normal fan to the associahedron?
No. There is a connection with the associahedron, but maybe we'll talk about that. We can talk about that afterwards. So in particular, it's only an n-3 dimensional cone in three spaces. So if I wanted to draw for n equals 5, I have a two-dimensional fan in R to the 5. Now, it's somewhat hard to visualize a two-dimensional fan in R to the 5. But what we can do is you've got a two-dimensional fan in R to the 5. Intersect it with the four-dimensional sphere. Okay, if you intersect your two-dimensional fan with the four-dimensional sphere, you get a graph. This is the graph I'm drawing here. So I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 3, 4, 5, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30, 31, 32, 33, 34, 35, 36, 37, 38, 39, 40, 41, 42, 43, 44, 45, 46, 47, 48, 49, 50, 51, 52, 53, 54, 55, 56, 57, 58, 59, 60, 61, 62, 63, 64, 65, 66, 67, 68, 69, 70, 71, 72, 73, 74, 75, 76, 77, 78, 79, 80, 81, 82, 83, 84, 85, 86, 87, 88, 89, 90, 91, 92, 93, 94, 95, 96, 97, 98, 100, 101, 102, 103, 104, 105, 106, 107, 108, 109, 110, 111, 112, 113, 114, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30, 31, line is really a two-dimensional cone. Okay. This corresponds to the trees of the sort 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. This will correspond to trees of the form 4, 5, 1, 2, 3. This would correspond to trees of the form 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, you remember what this means is I'm keeping track of the length of the internal edge. So that will tell me how far along the rays are. So another way of saying this is that this is the moduli space of tropical lines. A tropical line over a field with evaluation looks something like this. Okay. So what do we want to finish? Maybe I should, because I'm just almost out of time. I'm going to say the punchline which is that the closure of M0N in this X sigma is M0N bar. So this is the moduli space of stable curves. Stable. We have a lot of connections between my toric variety and M0N. So for example, so note, we have the Picard group of M0N bar equals the Picard group of my toric variety X sigma. Even more, the Chow rig of M0N bar, again, this is one of those nice varieties, in this case, maybe, I guess Joe didn't say rational variety, just some nice rational varieties, where we know what the Chow rig is. And here it's even equal, so stronger than this, it's equal to the Chow rig, appropriately interpreted, of the toric variety. Okay, so that means any intersection calculation you want to do on the toric variety, you can do, you want to do on M0N bar, you can do on the toric variety. Toric intersection theory, remember I said, is something that's really, we really understand and did it well. And even more, we could say M0N bar intersects the orbit of O sigma. So this is the orbit of X sigma is curves with dual graph the tree labeled by sigma. The names and the intersection of, so if I look at this cone, the intersection of M05 bar with the torus, the one-dimensional torus orbit here will consist of, with the zero-dimensional torus, I guess the codimension 2 torus orbit here will consist of just this one. There's one curve in M05 bar that looks like this, and it will consist of this. So there's a tight connection, somehow this toric variety and the tropical variety keeps track of all the combinatorics of M0N bar. So I think this is a sort of a nice example of this tropical compactification phenomenon. So I'll stop there.